is going to be just a survey of the solar system. And it's actually a modification, update, expanded version of a talk they gave the first time I was here, which was, I believe, well, now 6.5 years ago. And so this is the first time I've rotated back. The last time I was doing a talk, I was saying, oh my God, I'm finishing it in the car, right? And right before, and worked like 24 hours to get it ready, just barely. And Emily and I drove up together from Lehigh, and she drove back, and she said I was snoring before we got out of the driveway. So anyway, exploration of the solar system. Maybe one day we'll be driving convertibles out to Saturn, and let's see where we go from here. I think I discovered the trick to making this work. Yeah. And there's a bit of history in here, too, in this talk, and even a bit of science fiction. But for most of human history, the moon was a circle in the sky with a fly on it. Right. And although part of a circle sometimes, but we understand the phases, it wasn't until about 400 years ago that Galileo aimed a telescope at the moon, and the moon turned from a circle in the sky into a world. A world with mountains and valleys, a world with terrain, and some of it very interesting. The moon is about 1/4 the diameter of the Earth, and gravity on the surface is about 1/6 of it is what it is on the Earth. So these pictures are roughly, this picture's roughly to scale. One of the most conspicuous features on the moon, aside from linear rills and sorts of things like that, are the craters, which have an interesting morphology that goes from bowl shape when they're relatively small to flat bottom when they're relatively large. They very often have one peak in the center and sometimes multiple peaks, which occur when the object from space that hits the moon and compresses the moon, it rebounds explosively up the center to create the central peak. So these are impacts from, you know, objects that are moving around the solar system. That was known, you know, by the 1950s and 60s for sure. There are mountain ranges on the moon, which are very much unlike Earth mountain ranges. They are not caused by plate tectonic processes. These are actually, you know, if you look at them, they all look like they're semicircles, parts of circles. They're actually the boundaries of large craters called impact basins, many of which are filled with lava, which leads to the mare regions, the dark regions, that are easy to distinguish with the naked eye even from Earth. But we didn't really learn a whole lot more about the moon until we could actually get closer and explore it. And the first series of spacecraft to actually go to the moon had to use rocketry. The V-2 rocket is the kind of quincentennial rocket. It really is the start of the modern age of rocketry. And Wernher von Braun, who designed this, also designed the Saturn V rocket that took American astronauts to the moon in the late 1960s and into the early 70s. One of the first spacecrafts that visited the moon was Luna 1, and it impacted the lunar surface in 1959. It didn't do anything else, but it did basically demonstrate that we could, in fact, reach the moon from a spacecraft that left the Earth's surface. Luna 3 actually carried out an interesting mission in that in 1959 it passed around the far side of the moon. The moon keeps one face always toward the Earth. So throughout all of human history, until 1959, no human being had ever seen the other side of the moon. This side of the moon here is actually part of the near side. This is the far side. And the moon actually has two different types of features. The near side is very heavily cratered, and there are a lot of these mare regions. The far side also cratered, but there are very few of those dark, lava-filled basaltic regions on the surface of the far side of the moon. And we didn't know that until 1959. Although, looking at, like, as you would go around the edge of the moon, there was some hints that maybe the other side of the moon looked different. The first American spacecraft to go to visit the moon was designed to, simply crash on the moon. Right? But all the way down, it would be taking pictures, and the so-called Block 2 missions that ran around 1962 had another part to them that most people aren't aware of. It had like this balsa wood sphere that would pop off the spacecraft and semi-soft land, meaning bang, onto the surface of the moon. And if it worked, it would send telemetry back to the Earth on seismographic information. Because you see, back then, no one knew whether the moon was a dead world with no volcanic activity or still alive. There were a lot of hints, turned out to be, I believe, incorrect, of venting on the moon that had been seen by, or claimed to have been seen by, some astronomers. But we now believe the moon has been inactive for probably, you know, 3 to 3.5 billion years. So anyway, it turns out none of these missions worked, Rangers 3, 4, and 5, these Block 2 missions. And in fact, this became a major political issue that actually led to 3 congressional committee investigations. Because here are the Russians, right? The Russians are, you know, sending these things to the moon. They got these giant rockets carrying much more payload than ours. They're beating the pants off us in practically every way. And our spaceships are going to the moon and failing in all sorts of ways. You know, and one of the Rangers actually, because of the wrong sign in a computer code, when it fired a rocket to correct its trajectory to move it in the direction of the moon, it actually was a negative sign instead of a positive sign. It fired the rocket and went in the wrong direction. So basically, people in Congress and politicians in the United States were pulling their hair out because we're not getting anywhere. One after another, the spaceships are exploding, they're missing the moon, all sorts of things are going wrong. And then, very reliable. And then after this investigation and this examination, all these recommendations were made. The recommendations were to simplify the spacecraft. And one of the simplifications was to eliminate the landing sphere. So they created the Block 3 missions, which included Rangers 6 through 9, which ran from 64 to 65. And Ranger 6 actually reached the moon right on target. But cameras didn't take any pictures. And they figured out why. Actually, it turned out that electrical circuitry was burned out as the spacecraft was on its way up, and some kind of ionization, which they managed to shield in later missions. But Rangers 7, 8, and 9 were extraordinarily successful. And Ranger, one of the three, I forget which one, this may have been Ranger 8 or 9, took this picture so that we started to see details that were better than any that we could see with Earth-based telescopes, at least with the kind of film we were using back then. And there's one that's even more remarkable. This is one of the last ones taken. And I can tell you one thing I noticed years ago was how rounded the moon appeared to be. All the old pictures showed spiky mountains, and we figured, yeah, well, there's no erosion on the moon, so all the features would be sharp, right? But it turns out there is erosion on the moon. You might call it cosmic abrasion from micrometeoroids that are continually impacting the moon's surface over billions of years, acting out to soften all the features. But that up there would represent in this picture what would be about the size of a football field. So, for example, if your school were on the moon, you'd see it in this picture, right? You know, I mean, that's about a football field size, and a school is a pretty good fraction the size of a football field. Your school has a gym, right? Mm-hmm. And I always thought it'd be a great idea to put a school on the moon with a gym. Because if you seal the windows so all the air stayed in, right, you would have a gymnasium which was at 1/6 gravity. Which means if you weighed 120 pounds on the Earth, you'd weigh 20 pounds on the moon. If you could jump this high on the Earth, you'd be like the world's greatest basketball player on the moon. I mean, this would be absolutely amazing. You see, you know, when the teachers say the kids are so wild they're bouncing off the walls, they would be kidding. You'd actually be bouncing off the walls. And you could construct wings and you could fly. You'd have enough strength in your arms to fly on the moon. In your gymnasium, right? So, I mean, this would be like Harry Potter in real life. This would be fantastic. So, I believe that this nation should commit itself, before this decade is out, of landing a gymnasium on the moon. So make sure you demand this of your teachers and your principals, and then us pure poor scientists to go along. I mean, isn't like the Super Bowl like a fucking $1 billion industry here? Imagine the kind of athletic stadiums you could have up there. Us poor scientists could go and collect our rocks and make our measurements, right? It wouldn't cost anything.
Could
Yeah.
My father would tell me that the first six of those things, they were sterilizing them because they didn't want to harm the moon life.
Well, that's right. And we also know that the astronauts that came back from the moon, the first of them, not all of them, they were also held in isolation until afterwards to make sure they didn't bring anything back from the moon. So there was avoidance of contamination in both directions at that time. That's correct.
Well, they stopped sterilizing them. That's why the Ranger 7 worked.
That could have been part of the process. Yep. The next step after just crashing into the moon and taking pictures was to orbit the moon and take pictures so that they would be able to pick landing sites for the Apollo astronauts and also learn more about the geology and lunar morphology based upon orbital pictures that were pretty high resolution. But at the time, we didn't have digital cameras. So what they did was they took pictures on photographic film, which was developed on board and then slowly scanned and sent back to the Earth like in strips, which were then put together. It was called the world's most expensive drugstore because for those who weren't raised in the previous generation, that's where you used to take the film and your cameras to develop it. F-I-L-L, film, used to be something you'd have to put in a camera to actually make it work. So these orbited the moon and very successfully, and one of the pictures that actually was on the front page of the paper when I was a kid was this one, which on the front page it says, lunar orbiter makes the moon a star. Because, you know, they'd been aiming them straight down until that point, and they decided to shoot off some film, and they aimed it off at an angle and came up with this incredible picture, which I believe is Copernicus' crater, actually.
Yes.
The Russians then beat us again. Of course they beat us. They knew we weren't going to do these things, so all they had to do was do it 2 months before we did, right? They were the first to land on the lunar surface with Luna 9, and there's an interesting story behind this, because, and by the way, I have a scrapbook from when I was a kid, and this is actually from that scrapbook. These are newspaper clippings, because there were many Russian crashes that they didn't admit to, but we knew, because we could monitor the radio transmissions. We know, you know, it's like when that line goes straight on those hospital movies. You know the patient's having a really bad day. You know, so this was pretty much happening there. So anyway, you know, here's a picture of the Russian spacecraft on the lunar surface. And here is, you know, basically the first picture from the surface of the moon. Only the interesting thing is it wasn't provided by the Russians. You see, the British knew that, in fact, there was something being transmitted. So they wheeled a fax machine in, a facsimile machine, they hooked it up, and they got the picture that was being sent back from the moon by the Russian spacecraft and put it in the newspaper before the Russians did, which really got them mad, you know? So we had pictures on the front page of the paper from the surface of the moon before the Russians even knew that their country had landed on the moon. So anyway, you know, this was a picture, and here's part of the spacecraft down in the bottom corner of the picture. We then sent a spacecraft called Surveyor, and by the way, the reason we actually have a picture of it on the moon is that the Apollo 12 mission carrying two astronauts to the surface actually landed right by it deliberately. No, it wasn't an accident, like in the sci-fi movies where they happened to land by the only interesting thing on the entire planet accidentally, right? No, they actually landed there. So number one, they can demonstrate the capability of pinpoint accuracy in landing. I mean, Apollo 11 missed by several miles. And also to bring the spacecraft or a piece of it, they cut off the camera and some of the wiring back to Earth to find out what the lunar environment did to an object, including one that had some bacteria, you know, in the wiring, you know, after being on the moon for about 2.5 years. So Surveyor landed on the moon. It took about 10,000 photographs. Actually, the first one even lasted through an entire lunar night. This picture is actually amazing because, I know it doesn't look like much, but you know, in these early missions, one of the first photos was often of the landing leg of the spacecraft. And you know, so when you look at this picture, you see pebbles and dirt and rock throughout all of human history.
The moon was 240,000 miles away. Suddenly, we are on the surface. The moon is up close in your face. It's right there in your face. And we can see rocks and pebbles on the moon, something that had never occurred in human history. So there were a lot of firsts taking place in the 1960s. Here is a picture that's actually a composite of many pictures showing the region around one of the lunar, one of the surveyor landers. Now, how did we get people to the moon? This is one of the spacecraft orbiting the moon, the one that carries three astronauts. And I want to tell you the story about how we did that, because this is really pretty amazing. Of course, it all starts with human imagination. Imagination appears in drawings and paintings and movies, science fiction movies. There's one painting that shows astronauts on Titan, the moon of Saturn, with Saturn up in the background. It's called the painting that launched a thousand careers, because it basically was so inspirational that people went into science and engineering. And here's an artist's conception of standing on the moon in the presence of Earthlight in some lunar mountains. But how did we actually get there? Well, the story doesn't start with the rocket that brought us there. It started earlier than that, when, and I'm going to be talking about American missions here, because ultimately we did get to the moon and the Russians didn't. It started with a spacecraft called Mercury that was designed to take one astronaut, either using a Redstone rocket up and down, or another astronaut into orbit around the Earth using a more powerful Atlas rocket. The spacecraft looked like this. This is actually kind of a drawing of the Mercury spacecraft as it's orbiting the Earth. Basically, there was no room to move. They would just bolt the astronaut in there. And you can see here's where the astronaut would be seated. Hardly any room. There were some maneuvering controls. There was a retro rocket pack that would be fired in the reverse direction in which the spacecraft was moving to bring it down to Earth. And then there was a heat shield on this side that was ablative, meaning that it would be burned off in little pieces, carrying the heat away as it re-entered the Earth's atmosphere, raising the temperature to thousands of degrees. The next mission was called the Gemini mission. Gemini, the constellation of twins. In fact, you see a pair of astronauts were sent up into orbit on a Titan rocket, which was actually a rocket used for intercontinental ballistic missiles that actually used a hypergolic fuel, where the two fuels would burn immediately upon contact, so one didn't need an ignition system. Here is a picture of one of them taken by another one, because there was a time that both of them went into orbit together. Almost didn't happen, because the one that was going up to meet the other one, the rocket engine started and shut down in an emergency. Something detected, something I believe in the fuel line. And these, because these weren't explosive fuels, they just burned quickly, these didn't have escape towers that pulled the capsule away, but they had ejection seats. And if that astronaut, once the rocket engine started and shut down, had been worried that the bolt holding it had been broken at that point and it was going to fall over, he would have fired the ejection seats, blown the inside of the capsule to smithereens, and ended any possibility of a mission there where two spacecraft were in orbit at the same time. But he didn't. He kept his cool. He didn't press the button. He realized the thrust didn't get up high enough for the rocket to become released. And in fact, they were able to get the mission up there while the others were still in orbit. So the Gemini mission had three mission objectives. One of them was long duration. Because if you were going to go to the moon, it was going to be at least like a 6-day trip. 2.5 days there, 2.5 days back, about a day on the moon. The longest mission from the Gemini was 2 weeks. Now, let me tell you something about those 2 weeks. You couldn't move. You were in your spacesuit. You were pooping in your pants. That's it. 2 weeks of that. Can you imagine that? Being stuck in a telephone booth for 2 weeks in that position, right? You had better be really good friends with the other guy. Right? Extravehicular activity. You had to learn how to step out of the spacecraft. When you got to the moon, you didn't want to just stay inside. You're going to have to get out. And you might have to get outside to work on things like a space station. The other was rendezvous, because in the Apollo program to go to the moon, we'd need to bring two spacecraft together in orbit, both around the Earth and around the moon, and on the way to the moon, in fact. So we had target vehicles, generally the upper stages of some rocket with docking columns so that you could dock with it. In fact, one of the Gemini was blasted from its nominal orbit of about 200 miles up to about 800 miles by firing the rocket engine on the Agena target vehicle, which still had fuel left, so they used that to bring them up to a higher altitude, which was kind of cool. We were sending all sorts of firsts back then. You know, basically, you know, long duration, extravehicular activity, rendezvousing, connecting with another object in orbit, and blasting that rocket to bring you up to 800 miles. Because you see, 1 to 200 miles isn't very high. People say, oh my God, we're in space, we're weightless. No, the Earth is 8,000 miles in diameter. 1 or 200 miles up like this is like that. Imagine taking a globe of the Earth. The astronauts are about this high, okay? So the only reason you're weightless is because you're falling like in a broken elevator, right? The gravity is still about the same. If you built a tower that tall and you stood there, you only weigh slightly less than you do on the surface. But anyway, 800 miles, now you are really beginning to get up there. So, where did we go from here? Well, the next step...
radiation, like, did they consider the solar flares and everything?
Solar flares were always a danger, although not here. They weren't a danger until we left the region of the Van Allen belts that circle the Earth. We are protected from radiation from low Earth orbit, like the space station. We are not protected when we leave the Earth's orbit. Yeah. We were during the entire missions of the Apollo.
I meant the moon missions.
The moon mission. There is a movie about a moon mission where the astronauts get exposed. On the surface and in the lunar lander was the most dangerous because there was no shielding. In the command module on the spaceship that they used to get to and from the Earth, they were well shielded. But in that movie, they die on the way up because of the solar radiation, because of a solar flare. But fortunately, we were in a period of low solar activity, and there were no flares while they were on the surface. Otherwise, they would have to get off the surface and attempt to get back to the spacecraft, the main spacecraft, as quickly as they could. Absolutely. But these missions didn't suffer from that problem. The rocket that took us to the moon is the Saturn V rocket. 350 feet tall, 7.5 million pounds. And in order to lift this giant off the pad, these rocket engines would burn fuel at such a rate that if you imagine a built-in swimming pool, it would burn that much fuel every 4 seconds. And that's what it took to lift this monster off the surface of the Earth and take it to the moon. The spacecraft had actually three parts. A what was called the command module, where the three astronauts were, the service module, which contained rocket engines and a fuel cell for generating electricity, also producing water for drinking and cooling, and a very fragile lunar lander designed to take two of the three astronauts to the surface. This thing, in order to make this light enough to bring there, the walls of this spacecraft are the equivalent thickness of three pieces of aluminum foil, which means it had virtually no shielding from any kind of radiation that might come from this during the solar flare. They would be dead, yeah. I mean, basically, there's monitoring of the sun, and if any activity were found, and they could get back to the command module in time, which was much more robust, because this thing was, you know, heat shielding all around, it was very robust. It could withstand that, and it also had to withstand the passage of 25,000 miles an hour into the Earth's atmosphere. This could. They would die like they did in that movie.
What about the galactic radiation? Would you handle that one?
Not for the duration that they were out there for. Cosmic radiation is a big issue in terms of like multi-month missions, like 6 or 7 months going to Mars. You know, so one does have to figure out how to deal with that and how much radiation they would get on the surface of Mars, which does not have protective environment like we do here on Earth. The command module, basically contained the three astronauts. It looks pretty cramped, but it actually turns out that once you're weightless, there's a lot of room for moving around in and underneath here. So they actually would say that it was pretty spacious, especially when comparing it to the others. The inside looks like this. You know, if you're looking down from the top, here are the three seats, there, there, and there. They don't look anything action there, Adam. They don't look anything like the seats you see in science fiction movies, which are either very well cushioned. They're in spacesuits when they're actually doing anything important in the spaceship, like firing the rockets for interlanding back on Earth. They don't look like the seats you might find on the Galileo space shuttle of Star Trek, which look like they were taken from a very inexpensive conference room. So I never really quite understood that. Here is an artist's conception of the spacecraft landing, and here is what it looks like when you're looking out these triangular windows. The astronauts have to stand when they land. The reason for that was to reduce weight, because if they sat, they would be far from the windows, so you'd need more glass. Glass is very heavy. If you can be standing, you can get their face close to the windows, which means the windows could be much smaller to provide the same field of view. Plus, the human legs are very good shock absorbers. We landed on the moon 6 times, so 12 human beings have walked on the surface of the Earth at the site shown in the picture there. This is a picture off the television set, you know, of the Apollo 11 astronaut. That was the kind of picture quality we had back then, you know, landing on the moon. I'm amazed at what we see now. Wouldn't it have been cool if we could have had it back then? Photographs taken from the surface in later missions, starting with Apollo 15, 16, and 17, carried a lunar rover with them so that you could explore the moon more thoroughly. And, you know, here's a picture of an astronaut. By the way, the moon is dirty. It's like really dirty. It's dirt. It sticks to you, even though it's not wet. It's kind of like, you know, baking powder, you know, like a flour, I should say, you know, that just sticks to everything.
Weren't they expecting more dust on it?
They were worried about dust. Turns out it didn't actually cause problems. Well, although the Apollo 12 commander, Al Bean, actually said that he doesn't really remember if he was seeing the moon's surface through the dust when he landed. They had a little part of the landing leg that stuck down, and when it touched the bottom, when it touched the moon's surface, it turned on a light. And that's, you know, that's when they would cut off the engines, and then they would drop the last few feet, because they were worried that the dust would be thrown up during landing. But the interesting thing is, if you watch videos of anything where the dust is thrown up, because of the lack of atmosphere, it just goes boom. It just follows a ballistic trajectory right to the ground and immediately disappears. But it didn't seem to affect any of the equipment or do any damage. There was a Russian lunar rover that rode the moon for a very long time, and they had to investigate a lot of ways of keeping parts lubricated and moving in such a dry and dusty environment where electrostatics really plays an important role. You can't just oil this stuff. So, you know, after going through these pictures of the moon, we do have a picture of the Earth taken by the astronauts. This is what the Earth looks like from a position between the Earth and the moon. I mean, look at this world. You can see the blue of the oceans. You can see the clouds indicating an atmosphere. You can see the green of the jungles of Africa. You know, you can tell by looking at the picture that this is a world of life. In fact, it's more than that. It's a world with intelligent life. Oh, I can't use this line here, can I? I was going to say with the possible exception of parts of New Jersey. Oh, wait a minute, I'm in New Jersey. With the possible exception of parts of, West Virginia. Okay.
Washington, D.C.
Washington, D.C. Well, I can pick a whole lot of places, right. The Earth is one of, you know, if you include the dwarf planet Pluto, one of 9 planets, or officially now one of 8 planets, third from the Sun. These distances, of course, aren't to scale, but the sizes are. Jupiter's the largest planet, and here's how it looks compared to Earth. Here's Jupiter looks compared to the Sun. And there's us, this tiny little dot there. So there's the Earth compared to Jupiter, Jupiter compared to the Sun. So, you know, with all of our bold thoughts about ourselves, that's all we are, is that little pale blue dot, as Carl Sagan once said. So let's take a trip out beyond the moon now and take a look at the other worlds. The closest world to the Sun is Mercury, and this is about the best Earth-based picture of Mercury that I've ever seen. Mercury being close to the Sun means that it is never far from the horizon. In other words, you're always looking through thick atmosphere just before the sun rises or just after the sun sets. So that is a photograph of Mercury showing more detail than, you know, most people are likely to see. We sent a spacecraft sent the Messenger spacecraft. We did send Mariner 10 earlier, but Messenger went into orbit around Mercury, and Mercury is very cratered like the Moon, although there are features on Mercury that are unlike the Moon. I've got to learn these again since I just discovered I'm going to be teaching planetary astronomy in the fall after not having taught it for many years, and oh my God, I don't remember anything. It's like amnesia. I used to be able to spout off things about Mercury, something about differences between that and the Moon. I don't remember. So now, the next three are very interesting worlds. Venus, very close in size to the Earth, cloud covered. So, you know, until we got spacecraft out there, we couldn't see the surface, and we could only guess the ripple of the clouds. And Mars, I'll get to in a minute, which is actually a smaller world than most people realize. Venus is, again, you know, even when we sent spacecraft out there, and this is a spacecraft picture, not Earth-based, but it looked pretty much the same, is cloud covered, you can't see through the surface. So for the longest times, we could only kind of guess what the surface was like. And since we didn't know the composition of the clouds, we could guess that the clouds might be composed of water droplets, like those that make up clouds on Earth. So people pictured that perhaps Venus is a jungle world, right? Or maybe even an ocean world. Because even though it's closer to the sun, it should be warmer, it shouldn't be that much warmer. And besides, the clouds would reflect away much of the sunlight, reducing the amount of solar radiation that does actually get to the surface. So maybe Venus would be this wonderful vacation world, like a solar system Florida. But then again, you know, without being able to detect water vapor in the atmosphere, there are those who would say that maybe Venus is a dry desert world. And it was very hard to know. We found out that, you know, with an American spacecraft that actually passed by, Mariner 2 was the first one to actually give us information about the surface, because it was designed to try to distinguish between some kind of atmospheric effect that made it look like the surface was hot, because it did seem to be hot based on certain infrared studies, right? Or if it was actually incredibly hot. It turned out that we learned that this Venus was, its surface wasn't just a little warmer than it is on Earth. The surface temperature is 900 degrees. 900 degrees, summer, winter, daytime, nighttime, North Pole, South Pole, all the time, everywhere, 900 degrees. And the atmospheric pressure nearly 100 times what it is on Earth. You could jump off the roof of a building without a parachute and float to the surface as though you were underwater. That's how thick the atmosphere is. The Russians amazingly managed, after some unsuccessful tries, to land a spacecraft on the surface of Venus and got photographs like this. These missions never lasted on the surface very long. At that temperature, they lasted maybe 2 hours. And that was the end of them. But we got information and some spectroscopic information and some photographs from the surface. Although there's one interesting footnote to that. They have like this arm that comes out and touches the soil and would analyze the composition. But one of them came out right on top of the lens cap that was ejected from the lens. So the thing landed on time. There's no way to move it. So that was it. No information from the surface. They could figure out what their lens cap was made of, and that was about it. Now, will people ever go to Venus? Now think about this. Venus has an atmosphere that's thicker than the Earth's and gravity that's almost the same. It takes like a Saturn V rocket to get us anywhere, right? We'd have to get a Saturn V rocket to the surface of Venus so we could get off. And you know what? Warming something is much easier than cooling, right? How in the world are you going to keep anything cool that's at 900 degrees for very long? I don't know. But we could imagine what it might be like. So try to imagine what it would be like in Venus. Imagine. I think that this is unrealistic, and that in fact I would make a complete ash of myself doing something like this. What does life on Venus look like? I don't know. Some artist's conception showed some Venusian creatures made of silicon instead of carbon, eating one of the Russian spacecrafts.
Space stations in operation for landing and refueling. Apparently we have some deadly neighbors in outer space.
Captain, it's heading towards.
And now the story of a fantastic adventure that befalls mankind's most daring crew of space explorers.
A sound. In the hum of an insect. Is this a dead planet?
Landing on an unknown planet, they are captured by long-limbed beauties. When they say, take me to your leader, and they take them to a creature like this, you know they're on planet Venus. And the queen of outer space is Zsa Gabor. The most talked-about woman in the world knows what she wants on Venus.
So, that's the best movie we have about the planet Venus. With Zsa Gabor. Which now brings us to the next planet in the solar system, the planet Mars. Now Mars is our second nearest neighbor, actually. When you look at Mars, you realize that aside from its size, being only about half the diameter of the Earth, it has a polar ice cap like the Earth. It has a day that's about 24 hours. A little more than 24 hours, you get a little more sleep, better than Earth. You can tell it has an atmosphere because you can see clouds. The red areas were thought to be deserts. That turned out to be true. These gray-green areas were thought to be vegetation that waxed and waned with the season. That turned out not to be true, unfortunately. But in the early days, there was a scientist named Percival Lowell. Actually, he wasn't a scientist. He was a rich guy. But he wasn't a bad guy. I mean, he built Lowell Observatory. Basically examined Mars very closely through a telescope, and he claimed to have seen these straight lines, which he called canals. He was sure that the Martians created a network of canals to move water from the melting polar ice caps to irrigate the rest of their dying planet. He even said that Mars is inhabited by beings of some sort or other. We may consider certain as it is uncertain what those beings may be. And of course, that spawned a lot of science fiction. War of the Worlds, right, where the Martians don't just build canals, they come to Earth to take over. We imagine building cities on Mars in the future under domes. You know, much of science fiction is devoted to this. I have this book, you know, that has a picture showing canals radiating out from the polar ice caps of Mars, channeling the waterways, and even green areas, marshy areas here where vegetation is growing. This is a postcard I got at the Hayden Planetarium that still showed canals long after we knew they no longer existed, or never existed. And for some reason or other, a cigarette commercial advertisement with canals on Mars, which was a little bizarre and hard to understand. There is a science fiction movie called Rocket Ship XM, where some astronauts try to go to the moon, but end up landing on Mars and finding a world. Notice that they're wearing oxygen masks without pressure suits. You see, well, we used to think that Mars had a thicker atmosphere, that much of it was nitrogen and not easily detectable from Earth. So we figured, well, maybe there's not enough oxygen to breathe, but certainly the atmospheric pressure ought to be at least 10 to 50% what it is on the surface of the Earth, so maybe you wouldn't need pressure suits. And I'm going to attempt to get this to work once again, because I have another video clip I'd like to show you, one of the better science fiction movies about Mars from the old days. So here they are on the surface of Mars. All right, this is the best clip I could find.
Looks like Arizona to me.
Notice the apartment coloring? Just more of the same.
Raspberry red, lemon yellow, orange orange.
Manganese, copper, nickel, pitch blast,
platinum, zircon, molybdenum, sterling, aquarius, colloids, spiders.
Taking out a plan here. Just making sure we can find our way back.
You talking to me?
And the bonus goes right into my sternum.
Who brought the sandwiches?
Sandwiches?
Mars is a desert world, turns out to be right. We'll find out in a moment that the atmosphere pressure is a lot less than we thought.
Well, just go anywhere. You said it.
It's another planet, for God's sakes. Yes, it's going to be a lot of rockets.
They've got pale faces and pinheads and fishy eyes.
I've heard that said about Texans, too.
What
did
he say? Forget it. Let's go collect some maggots.
There is a part of it I want to show you. That's something that they actually thought about a little bit on making a movie about Mars.
Hey, look, guys, there's the Statue of Liberty. There's James Franciscus and Charlton Heston.
You did it! You finally did it! Damn you all to hell!
Look at the wood. I mean, they don't realize at that time that that would have been the most important discovery in human history.
Studies are everywhere.
All right. Once in that log, anybody? We're going to get some roasted chicken.
So they thought that finding the remains of a Martian civilization was interesting, which of course it would be. But they don't realize that if we find that life originated, or even the fossilized remains of life on any other planet, it would be probably what you might consider the most important discovery in human history, because it would mean that life is everywhere in the universe if it's found to have appeared independently on two planets in the same solar system. So continuing with our story about Mars, I'm sorry, let me just go back ahead to where I was here. No. Now that this button is temporarily working.
How would you show it's independent?
That's one of the problems. I mean, DNA has a certain characteristic, and there are certain accidents involved, and it would be very unlikely that it would be reproduced just that way on another world, since old DNA on Earth has the same form. Now, that might be a very hard question to answer.
Yeah.
Now, as time went on, the people who originally saw very straight lines for canals started to realize that, well, maybe they were making them straighter than they really appeared. So, they began questioning that. And then what about the albedo features? These gray-green darker areas that seemed to become more pronounced when, like, the polar cap, waned and melted. Well, it turns out that if you look at plant life in infrared, and this is a picture taken in infrared light from my office window, you can see that anything with chlorophyll, right, the stuff in plants, actually looks very white. So to determine whether chlorophyll was in fact part of this Martian plant life, they took pictures of Mars in red and infrared light, and there's virtually no difference. Turned out that these areas are not really green or even gray-green. They're actually red. It is not quite the same red as the red around them, and they appear to the eye to be grayish-green when viewed in the context of the surrounding rims. Mariner 4 was the first spacecraft to go to Mars, and this is the first picture it took. Not showing much, just kind of lighter and darker areas, even a little bit of cloud hovering above the surface there. But by the time we got in about three pictures or so, it was very depressing. Craters on Mars, my favorite planet. Mars, it seems like as dead as a doornail, right? So that's the way things persisted for quite a while. We discovered that Mars had craters like the moon. The atmospheric pressure on Mars was only 7,000 of what it is on Earth.
And a large part of the polar ice cap wasn't even water ice, it was frozen carbon dioxide, frozen soda pop. So, you know, my God. But then we went back with other spacecraft that passed by, took more pictures, orbited Mars, and even landed, and we discovered some amazing things about Mars. They presumably dormant volcanic peak that's 15 miles tall, three times higher than Mount Everest. A canyon that would dwarf the Grand Canyon on Earth and run clear across the continental United States. Dust storms that literally consume the planet so that they disappear from view. The whole planet disappears from view for periods of months. But the most amazing one, dry riverbeds. Water may not flow on Mars now, but it did in the past. And where there was water, there could have been life, and there could be fossilized remains, which brings us back to that very, very important question of that how common it is that life emerges on a planet, anywhere in the universe. This is what the surface of Mars looks like, but it looks kind of like Arizona, right? If you went out there without a spacesuit, you would freeze, right? You would suffocate. Your lungs would dry up like raisins as the water vapors dragged out of them. You'd explode, and then your dick would get like really bad. So don't do what I did and stole like a weather station and go onto the surface of Mars. See that picture on a show me going like that. So. Anyway, here's a photograph of Mars taken by one of these. Oh, by the way, the person who is the science chief investigator and basically the person who helped design the spacecraft and operated the whole mission, Stephen Squires, is coming to Lehigh University to give a talk at 4 p.m. on Thursday, March the 29th. March 29th. So Lehigh University, Lewis Lab 270. March 29th, Stephen Squires, the head of this mission, is going to give a special lecture about his experience. So there's the surface of Mars, very desert-like. There's another picture that looks a lot like Mars, but it actually isn't. You see, I watched the movie The Mummy this morning, and it's part of North Africa. So that's Brandon Fraser there, and these are other guys. So anyway, here are pictures taken by either Spirit or Opportunity. Opportunity, I believe, is one of the two that's still operating, actually, even though Curiosity was. Here's Mars, very desert-like, right? Here is another picture showing layering in the Mars, very important to geologists trying to understand the history of the Martian surface. This is the Earth from Mars. That's us. This is us. That's all of us right there, okay? And boom! That is a sunrise on Mars. No human being has seen the sunrise from the surface of another world. Now, we haven't been to the moon since 1972. We went in 69 and didn't go back until, and never have gone back since the last mission in 72. My message to you younger people, don't let it end this way. Don't let it end this way. We need to do amazing things. You need to go back to the moon, colonize. There are no other intelligent life forms in the solar system. We own it, we need to take over it. You need to go to go to Titan, a moon of Saturn that I'll talk about in the solar system, the only moon that has an atmosphere, and you can get some spacecraft that's got a thick atmosphere. You can glide that baby in for a landing. You may do something amazing. You may build a bit. You may cure a major disease. You may build the world's longest suspension bridge, and so on and so forth. And when you do these things, I want you to send me a message. Brainmail me in the future. It won't be email. It'll be brainmail. Brainmail me a message. Brainmail me a message telling me that you remember. Brainmail telling me you remember the day we spoke about this and you changed the world. And remember this. No female has ever walked on the surface of the moon. Don't let it end this way. How dare they? Right? Get these women to the moon.
Where was I?
Oh, yeah.
Here are pictures of Mars taken from Earth-based telescopes. This guy, Damien Peach, takes some amazing photographs, an amateur.
What will Martians look like?
I don't know. I kind of like Marvin the Martian there because he's got that broom on his head. It's pretty dusty. I have a book where artists try to figure out what aliens might look like based on their environment. Mars has a low gravity, one third of the Earth, so perhaps their legs would be very thin. The air is thin, so you'd need large ears to hear on Mars. And maybe you could even wrap them yourself around themselves at night to keep warm in the cold Martian nights. So, you know what we could do? We could make a movie called The Ears of Mars, starring Prince Charles as the titanic king of the Martian semicircular canal. He dies and can't use the second part. Right? Well, then we have the giant planets, Jupiter, Saturn, the planet with the unfortunate name, and Neptune. Jupiter, the largest world, with the storm, the great red spot that's been going on for about 400 years, although some are saying it might be gone in about 10. I don't know if that's true or not.
It seems we've gotten redder recently.
It has gotten redder because it turned like just basically barely salmon for a while. Saturn, you know, perhaps the most beautiful planet in the solar system. Here is a digital image taken from Earth of Saturn. Digital photography has just revolutionized what you can do from Earth-based instruments. Uranus and Neptune, taken by the Voyager spacecraft. And, you know, here are them actually, Uranus and Neptune, taken from Earth-based telescopes, actually, using my Damia Beach. Here's Europa. Europa is perhaps one of the most interesting worlds in the solar system because its surface is ice. You can see it cracked. It's undergoing a sort of plate tectonics. It's just floating on a liquid ocean below it. One day we may melt our way through this ice to the perhaps largest unseen ocean in the universe. And again, where there's water on Earth, there's life. And who knows what we may found? Something with the body of a crab and the head of a school teacher, you know, who would probably, you know, if you're not paying attention, crab claw, you know, might to get your attention. There is a movie about Europa. This is called Europa Report. It's kind of a cool movie. And she knows she can't stay out there very long because of the radiation. It's a good movie, although it's one of those that seems to be, you know, like, kind of goes around like there's a camera aimed at people, you know.
What's the name of
it? It's called Europa Report. But it's kind of cool about the trip out there, about, you know, the losses, and about a very interesting discovery they make. So here's Io, you know, and by the way, why is there liquid water so far from the sun? Well, it has to do with the tidal forces. You know, the forces that are stretching and compressing the moon due to gravity generated by the giant Jupiter and the other moons in the system. And if you don't believe that's enough to melt the water, go one moon closer, Io, and that's the center of volcanic activity. This is the surface of Io, which in 2010, it looks almost exactly like that as you're looking down over the surface. Here is a drawing of a landing on Titan. You see, even in the 40s, we knew that Titan, the moon of Saturn, had an atmosphere. Now, we knew it had methane in it, so they kind of drew a blue sky up there, but kind of dark, indicating it might be thinner than the atmosphere on Earth. But it turns out, when we eventually sent spacecraft out there, it turns out to be completely cloud-covered like Venus. Turns out to be thicker than the Earth's atmosphere, mostly nitrogen like the Earth's atmosphere, except where we have water vapor and oxygen, they have methane, natural gas. When we send a spacecraft through the clouds, the Cassini dropped a lander called Huygens, took 2.5 hours to go down by parachute. I'm sure I wasn't the only one who fell off my chair when I saw this. Riverbeds! Riverbeds? It's 270 degrees below zero there. How can there be riverbeds? Answer, methane turns to liquid at 270 degrees below zero. So where we have water rain, water rivers, water lakes, water monsoons, they have methane rain, methane rivers, methane lakes, and methane monsoons on this world. As the spacecraft got lower and lower, we saw like a shoreline here. Turned out that there was no liquid in it at the time. There had been liquid in it and would be in other parts of the planet. And they've actually reached the surface, and the spacecraft lasted long enough on the surface, even though it wasn't known that it would, to take this picture from the surface. I use Photoshop to just kind of reverse it and give you a sense of what a wider field might look like. produced an unfortunate artifact in the front here. You know, somebody facing away from us praying, I guess, or something. But here is a radio wave image of the surface showing these lakes of methane and perhaps ethane as well. The asteroids in 1901, these were the number we knew. Here it was in 2001. We've actually sent spacecraft by asteroids, orbited asteroids, even landed on, you know, things that are asteroid or asteroid-like. This is Ida, here's Vesta. And Ceres, the largest of the asteroids, with these very interesting bright areas. I'm not sure they know what they are. It's not the evidence of intelligent life elsewhere. It's probably some kind of salt-like substance, but certainly very interesting, different from other parts. There is an asteroid named after Lehigh University, 691 Lehigh. There's a light curve, which is kind of like light curves that appear, I guess, there's no shadow of my finger when I go past this light over here. That's Emily and Ellen's work over there with other asteroids. We've actually sent spacecraft by comets. Halley's Comet, Hartley, the Rosetta of Philae landed on a comet on the surface. This is a picture taken from the lander itself of the surface of a comet before its battery died, because unfortunately it bounced and ended up in a shadow and couldn't get enough solar energy to continue the mission beyond the minimal. The orbital spacecraft actually got a picture of it right there. There it is, touching a shadow over there that prevented it from getting the light it needed to charge its batteries. But it got a lot of the scientific mission done before it died. Pluto, this was the would have been the last slide, you know, just, you know, the last time I showed this talk. But since then, we've actually had our spacecraft New Horizons pass by Pluto and its large moon, Charon. There's Pluto and Charon compared to the Earth in size. Here is real color and enhanced color. I think I've got that in the right direction. And, you know, here is Charon. Amazingly interesting worlds of frozen materials, carbon dioxide, nitrogen. Somewhat like Triton, moon of Neptune. You know, and some of the terrain is absolutely bizarre on this world. So here we're looking at Pluto, right? Not Charon. Even a thin haze. They wanted to get out there fast because Pluto was relatively close to the Sun. It's a very elliptical orbit, and they were afraid it would all freeze out before they got there if they waited too long for us actually to get on a mission out there. So you can see the haze. You can see there is a very, very, very thin atmosphere. Again, some really exciting pictures. We have thousands of planets circling other stars now. Who knows what we'll find when we get out there? I don't think it'll look like that, but it would be fun if it did. And there's one of our favorites, right, Martin, right there. We would need spaceships that go faster than light because of the immense distances involved, or at least sleeper ships if we were to take people, because it would be generations before we get there. They are talking about a mission to send tiny spacecraft to transmit back to Earth to Alpha Centauri. The Proxima Centauri, you know, its partner has a planet circling it. Here is the Andromeda Galaxy, which looks kind of like our galaxy, but look from a distance. It's home to approximately 100 billion stars, more than that actually, but it loves numbers. And the galaxy and the universe consists of 100 billion galaxies, each with 100 billion stars. All of these guys are entire galaxies. And so we've gone a little beyond the solar system, and here's where I stop. Thank you very much.